stepping out in faith, so the world will know your name. Christ alone be praised. This is the cry of his people. No matter what it takes, for the glory of your name. Christ alone be praised. We're stepping out in faith, so the world will know your name.
just want the real thing. No matter where it takes me, I refuse to pray a word that doesn't move me. All I know right now is I'm ready, and all I want right now is the real thing, Lord. You're the real thing, Lord. You're the real thing. It's who you are. Was broken, your love poured out, bled and you died for me there on the cross. You breathed your last as you were crucified. You gave it all.
Hey. upon the cross.
Again, there we go. Good morning. Welcome to Soul Sanctuary on this Easter Sunday. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. My name is Andrew.
And my name is Beth, and we're so glad that you've joined us this morning. Just a brief note of housekeeping before we start our gathering this morning. Because it's Easter Sunday and Baptism Sunday, we are expecting a lot of people with us this morning. So if you are sitting on the end of a row, and there's room in the middle of your row, we're gonna ask you to do us a favor and move into the middle of the row and make room for people who are still arriving.
In Matthew 21, verse 28, verse 1 to 7, it says this: After the Sabbath, at the dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men.
The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, and now I have told you, he is risen."
He is risen indeed. This morning is Resurrection Sunday, the morning where we celebrate the risen Christ. If you were with us at our Bad Friday gathering, you'll know that the Christ candle over there represents Jesus, who came and died and rose again from the grave. And so it's going to play a central part of our gathering over there.
Well, we're going to get our gathering started this morning. We're really excited for this morning, so we invite you to stand to your feet if you're able and join us in worship.
Praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I praise when I'm sure, I praise when I'm doubting. I praise when I'm numbered, I praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water my enemy's drowning. As long as I'm breathing, I got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise when I feel it, praise when I don't. Praise cause I know you're still in control. Praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. Cause praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise
faithful. Praise Him because You're true. Praise Him because there's nobody greater than You. I praise Him because You're sovereign. Praise Him because You reign. Praise Him because You rose and defeated the grave. Praise Him because You're faithful. Praise Him because You're true. Praise Him because there's nobody greater than You. Yeah, come on. Praise Him because You're sovereign. Praise Him because You reign. Praise Him because You rose and defeated the grave. Praise Him because You're faithful. Praise Him because You're true. Praise Him because there's nobody greater than You. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Good morning. We're continuing worship, and as we do that, we're going to take a moment to read. And we're in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19. And it says this: we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain. Jesus has entered there on our behalf as a forerunner, because He became a high priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. I think that's right. But this morning, as we gather today, we have so much hope because Jesus is risen. He's alive. We have we have such a reason to worship. Our King, He's not defeated. He is beyond, He defeated the grave. Let's worship together. Let's sing together.
Praise forever. once more for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was born. Truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint, but his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Praise forever.
Can take your seats. Hey, welcome again. If we haven't had the chance to meet before, my name is Andrew and this is Beth, and we are so glad that you have joined us this Easter Sunday. Whether it's your first time here, maybe you're a guest joining us for a baptism, or you've been here for a long time, we are just so glad that you have joined us. If you're curious about Soul, what Soul is all about, if you want to learn more about what it is and where you could fit, I encourage you to check out our next session of Growth Tracks, which starts next Sunday, April 7th, before the gathering.
Yeah, Growth Tracks is a three-week opportunity to explore who Soul Sanctuary is as a church, but also to take next steps in your relationship with God. If you want more information or you want to sign up, you can head to our website at soulsanctuary.ca/events.
That's right. Every Easter Sunday at Soul, we take up a special offering for one of our missions partners. And this year, the missions partner that we are taking up a special offering for is Home of the Good Shepherd in Brazil. And Home of the Good Shepherd, they take in kids and youth who come from unsafe living conditions, living with abuse, different stuff like that, and they provide them sanctuary and education and support, different life skills, stuff like that.
Pastor Jerry will give you more information about this later in the gathering, but we wanted to give you a heads up so that you can take some time to consider in your heart what you would like to give towards this initiative. You can give at the back of the room at the Joy Basket or at soulsanctuary.ca/give. Just make sure that you mark this gift as an Easter gift.
Today is also Baptism Sunday, a powerful symbol of Jesus' death and resurrection on the cross. It's a Sunday where we can celebrate with six individuals of our community who are taking next steps in their faith and publicly declaring that they want to follow Jesus for the rest of their lives. This is something that our whole community gets to participate and celebrate in, including our kids.
Here at Soul Sanctuary, we believe that parents are the primary spiritual influence in their child's life. So we want to give you an opportunity to witness and explain baptism together as a family.
That's right. And parents, this means that you'll actually be picking up your kids near the end of the gathering, but not after it's over. So Pastor Jerry will give a prompt from the stage, but also if you don't have one of these little pickup cards yet, it has instructions on it, tells you what it's all about. Make sure that you grab one from the Soul Kids banner out in the atrium during coffee time today.
This special pickup is for all of Soul Kids. So that means Soul Kids Junior age 1 and up and Soul Kids kindergarten to grade 5. Young Life will be dismissed to come down into the gathering on their own.
With that, kids, come on down to the front so that we can pray for you and send you off to Soul Kids. Parents, if you don't know where your kids are going, you can head to that same banner in the atrium after this moment and you'll find out where your kids need to go. How is everyone doing this morning? Happy Easter. Look how fast, you are running so fast and you have a pretty ring. That is so excited. Hey kids, can we try something together? Can I let you in on a little thing that we do sometimes at Easter? I'm going to say, "He is risen," and here's what I want you to do after that. As loud as you can, you shout, "He is risen indeed." Sound good? You ready? You do that at school? That's awesome. Okay, let's try it. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Was that as loud as we can go, do you think?
No.
Could we go a little bit louder, do you think? All right, it's a celebratory Sunday, so we got to be loud. We're celebrating that Jesus rose from the grave. All right, should we try it again? All right, he is risen.
He is risen.
Amazing. All right, I'm going to pass it over to Pastor Beth, who's going to pray for us before we head off to Soul Kids.
Okay, kids, let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for our kids. We thank you that you love them so much, that they're made in your image, and that they're created to know and respond to you. We pray that as they go to kids ministry this morning, that their hearts and minds would be attuned to you, that they would hear the words their teachers are speaking, and that they would understand what is being said through the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask God, as they grow and learn, that they would take steps to make their faith their own. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, kids, you can walk to Soul Kids with your walking feet. I see them. For the rest of us, this is coffee time. If you are a guest with us this morning, we're going to take about a 7 to 10 minute break. You can go out to the atrium, grab some coffee or tea, say hi to someone you don't know. But I'm going to tell you, you're going to want to hurry back into the sanctuary to hear our special Easter choir. So see you in a few minutes.
See my life.
I finally realized that I'm alive to bring glory.
mountains move. When you breathe, the dead arise, and the bones come back to life. There is power in this room, where the Spirit of the Lord.
Feels like, where the Spirit of the Lord is. Well, he is risen. Oh, the holiest day of the Christian calendar, and it's an exciting day. My name is Jerry, and if you're visiting today, I want to give you a personal welcome, and we are thrilled that you're here. As you've heard earlier today, every Easter we take up an offering, and our goal is to help out one of our mission partners in Brazil called the Home of the Good Shepherd. They are in the process of renovating a total of 7 bathrooms in 7 different cottages. So as you heard earlier, they take or they are given with the state children who have suffered numerous things, and they give them a safe place, a sanctuary. They educate them, they present the scriptures to them, and they help them heal and from their trauma, and eventually get them reintegrated back into society. The cost per cottage is $6,615. And their total renovation cost is $46,000. And so any help towards any of this would be hugely appreciated. Andrew and Beth have already shared how you can donate. You can go on Church Center online or give by the app or e-transfer at info@soulsanctuary.ca. Or you can mark it on a envelope and place it in the joy basket on your way out. So thank you for your generous donation and helping out people and kids in our community. I want to take you back. The year is 60 AD. It is 30 years after the resurrection of Jesus. The place is Caesarea. It's on the shores of the Mediterranean Sea. There's a man who comes to Caesarea, and he takes over from this mostly inept predecessor to be the new governor of this Roman province of Judea. The situation is very intense, and it's very unsettled. The Jewish people are a restless bunch, not noted for the gentle art of submission. And as this man sets up shop in Caesarea, he has one basic goal: to keep the peace, don't let things boil over. And it's not easy, because already the powerful winds of revolution are beginning to blow across the Roman Empire. The governor's name is Festus. Not Festivus, all right? Festus. He hardly steps off the boat coming from Italy. He runs into his first problem. See, there's a guy in prison in Caesarea, and it seems that he did something to upset the Jewish leaders. Upset is hardly the right word. They wanted him dead. And yet it's all vague and it's all very confusing. And so 3 days after Festus takes office, he makes a trip, a 100-kilometer trip down to Jerusalem to meet the Sanhedrin and to find out why they're so angry at this man back in Caesarea in jail. The man was in jail. His name is Apostle Paul. He had been there for 2 years, and frankly, he's very lucky to be alive at this moment. Now, according to Acts chapter 25, when Festus goes down to Jerusalem to meet with the Jewish leaders, they bring all these different types of charges against Paul, and they asked Festus to transfer the case from Caesarea back to Jerusalem. And it was all very transparent. People knew what was going on. They wanted to set up an ambush. They wanted to kill Paul. And failing that, they would at least have home field advantage if the trial was in Jerusalem. And it didn't work for various reasons, and so several of the influential leaders went with Festus back to Caesarea. Paul was then brought in to have a confrontation with them. Acts 25, verse 7 explains what happened. It says, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him, bringing many and serious charges against him, which they could not prove. They couldn't prove them because they weren't true. And so Paul simply says to Festus, I'm not guilty of anything. I committed no offense against the law of the Jews or against the temple or even against Caesar. But Festus wanted to do the Jews a favor. He's the new guy, right? And so he asked Paul if he was willing to go to Jerusalem and stand trial in Jerusalem. Now, understand, Festus isn't a bad guy. No, he's new on the scene. He doesn't know Paul. He doesn't know the Jewish law. He's a Roman governor. And this whole case is very mysterious to him. And so transferring the trial to Jerusalem is sort of like a compromise for Festus. And Paul is about as willing to go back to Jerusalem for a trial as he is to let a blind guy do brain surgery on him. And so the prospects were not very encouraging. And Paul replies this. He says, I am a Roman citizen, and I ought to be tried right here. If I'm guilty, punish me. If I'm innocent, I shouldn't be handed over to these men. And then he says something that will change the course of his life forever. He says, I appeal to Caesar. See, Paul got his Roman citizenship at birth. See, he was born the son of a Jewish Roman citizen in the city of Tarsus. So in the days of the Roman Empire, every Roman citizen actually had a right to make that appeal. If a Roman citizen felt he wasn't getting a fair hearing, he could appeal to Caesar. He could skip all the lower courts. And such a person then would be sent directly to Rome along with a statement of the facts in every case. And it was like appealing to the Supreme Court in our day today. There was only one catch. Once you made such an appeal, you couldn't change your mind later. So Paul keeps talking about his defense and also about a supposedly dead man named Jesus that Paul claimed was alive. Instead, they had some points of dispute with him about their own religion, about a dead man named Jesus whom Paul claimed was alive. Did you get that? A dead man named Jesus, who Paul claimed was alive. There in that one sentence is the whole problem of Easter. Paul believed it. The Jews didn't. And the Romans couldn't understand it. Roman law doesn't cover resurrections. Insurrections, yes. Resurrections, no. Right? The Jews said Jesus was dead. Paul said he's alive. Poor Festus doesn't have a clue what's going on. And to Festus, it's incomprehensible. He can't wrap his mind around it. He's never heard anything like this before. He doesn't know what to say or even where to begin. And Paul isn't guilty of anything. He's not a murderer. He's not a thief. He's not a criminal. He's a little kooky and maybe with this resurrection thing, but that's it. And at this point, two other people enter the scene in the story, King Agrippa and his sister Bernice. And we know him as Herod Agrippa II. He was the last of the line of King Herod's. His great-grandfather, Herod the Great, was the man who tried to kill the baby Jesus and had the infant boys of Bethlehem slaughtered. His grand-uncle, Herod Antipas, before whom Jesus was tried on that fateful night in Jerusalem. His father, Herod Agrippa I, was the one who murdered the apostle James and put Peter in jail. And now we have Herod Agrippa II, this king of a little tiny territory in the northeast of the Sea of Galilee. He's a relatively young guy, well-versed in the Jewish religion. He's a loyal friend of Rome. He and his sister have come to Caesarea to pay tribute to Festus and respects. And while they're there, Festus, he's unable to understand why the Jewish leaders hate Paul. And he decides to ask Agrippa for help. He doesn't have to. This isn't Agrippa's territory. And there is more or less a friendly consultant going on here. And Agrippa understands the Jewish law, but he also knows quite a bit about the story of Jesus. Because in fact, Agrippa was born about the same time that Jesus began his public ministry. In Acts 26, Paul begins to share his story, his testimony, of how he grew up a Jew and a proud Pharisee. His explanation is very simple. He affirms that as a Jew and as a Pharisee, he shares in the hope of what God promised to the Jewish people, a Messiah. And what follows actually in the book of Acts is probably the greatest defense of the Christian message there is in the New Testament. And in many ways, it's the climax of the book of Acts in chapter 26. So Paul retells the story of his conversion and proclaims the power of the resurrection. And then he asks a question that resonates throughout the centuries. Why should any of you consider it incredible that God raises the dead? And what a question that is for Easter morning. It's truly incredible that God should raise the dead? Like, what's more reasonable, that God raises the dead or that he doesn't raise the dead?
And it may interest you to know that this doctrine was troublesome from the very beginning. And as a matter of fact, in Acts chapter 4, verse 2, tells us in the earliest days of the Christian movement, when the church was on fire, the Jewish leaders were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. And Paul continues to tell how he would pursue early Christians and persecute them and even be involved in their deaths. Paul then shares his encounter with Jesus himself on the road to Damascus, and then how everything changes for himself at that moment. And now, instead of persecuting Christians, he is now a follower of Jesus as a result of this encounter. And then he goes on in verse 22 and he adds these words. He says, "But God has helped me to this very day. So I stand here and testify to small and great alike. I am saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer and, as the first to rise from the dead, would bring the message of light to his own people and to the Gentiles." At this point, Festus has heard absolutely enough. He interrupts Paul and he actually shouts, "You're out of your mind, Paul. Your great learning is driving you insane." Well, Festus reacts the way that all secular people react. First, it's about visions he's talking about, revelations and prophets, and finally Paul addresses a resurrection. And really, for some people, it's just too much to take in. Because no sane person should be talking that way. And that's really the final verdict of the secular mind, the non-believing mind. Festus has no other box. He has no other category to put stuff in. You know, truth or the possibility of truth doesn't enter in because everyone knows that a dead person stays dead. And there's simply no category for this strange doctrine that Paul is talking about. And Festus, he reluctantly concludes that Paul, who is obviously well-educated and smart, he's a brilliant man, the guy has simply gone nuts. He's crazy as a loon. Two bricks short of a full load. His study of the prophets has driven him nuts. There's no other explanation. And understand that Festus doesn't think that Paul is literally insane. Because you don't shout at somebody that you think is crazy. Work with me on this. You speak softly to them. You may pat them on the head. Right? Maybe you turn to the king and you wink. Right? You would never send a lunatic to the emperor's court in Rome. That's a bad career move, Festus. I wouldn't do that. Festus doesn't literally mean it. He just can't think of anything else. And for 2,000 years, people have looked at Easter and they've shaken their heads. They have heard the words. They know what we believe. But they don't know what to do with it all. And it's just too much to comprehend. And so the words of Festus ring across the centuries. "I was at a loss how to investigate such matters." And of course he was. And like every modern day Festus who stumbles over Easter and walks away scratching their head, we find ourselves in our culture today. It's still a problem today. Unbelief has 1,000 excuses. And some people refuse that God raises the dead because they have never seen it happen. They will only believe what they see. Others will say, "Well, I can't do it, and I don't know if anybody else can do it. Therefore, I don't think it can happen." And if I'm to freely admit this, in one sense, this is all on the side of unbelief, right? Go to any cemetery, start walking through it. What is it? It's quiet, it's peaceful, it's serene, it's beautiful. Nothing much happens in cemeteries except for the occasional funeral. And that's our problem with the idea of the resurrection. Funerals, we have aplenty. Resurrections, where are they? And I believe the issue is not fundamentally intellectual or scientific or mechanical or biological, as if we had somehow to understand how the dead are to be raised. But in the end, it's actually a problem of the matter of the heart. Many people simply don't believe what God has said. Others worship their own intellect. If they can't explain something, they assume it can't be true. But is it incredible to believe that God raises the dead? That word incredible actually can be broken down to impossible to believe. And let me answer one question with another. If God can create, why can He not recreate? We know that we came from dust, right? And to the dust we will return. We know that. And this life we have is simply temporary. It's a temporary respite for all of us going back to dust. And if God, who once gave life to dust, can He not do it again? Right? Cannot the watchmaker repair His broken creation? And to argue in such a manner on Easter Sunday may be helpful, but it's probably not satisfying for some of you here today. Because when we face our own death, and even more when we face the death of those that we love, we need more than arguments from logic and from philosophy. We need more. And that's what brings us back to the New Testament, to the question of what really happened on the first Easter Sunday. This is the conclusion of us walking through the book of Mark. And I pick it up in Mark 16, verses 1 to 8, and the accounts vary in their details, but the main outline is absolutely clear throughout the Gospels that early on a Sunday morning, while it was still dark, but just as the sun was about to come up, a group of at least five women, led by Mary Magdalene, have set out to the tomb of Jesus. They actually intended to anoint His dead body with spices, since there was a rush on Friday to get Him into the tomb before sundown. They haven't been able to fulfill and finish all that they wanted to do. And it's clear that they expected to find this tomb guarded by Roman soldiers with a dead body inside. So we have to imagine their shock when they arrived and they found the tomb open and Jesus' body gone. And so quickly returning to the other disciples, they spread the news that somebody had taken the body of Jesus. And then we have John and Peter running back to the tomb. John gets there first. Peter arrives a little bit behind. He's probably a little bit bigger, a little bit slower, but that's okay. He gets there seconds later, but he runs right inside. And what they find surprises them. The body is indeed gone, but the grave clothes are lying there exactly where they had been placed on the Friday before sundown. And the Jewish custom of burial wrapping the corpse with strips of linen interlaid with a combination of gummy resins and spices and would harden around the body. All that stuff was just sort of folded nicely. And so Peter and John, they see the grave clothes lying on the edge of the tomb. And not after that, long after that, Jesus appears to Mary. We read that He then appears to the women and then to Peter and then to the disciples on the road to Emmaus and then to other disciples. A week later, He appears to this guy by the name of Thomas, one of His followers who believed in spite of his own doubts, crying out to Jesus in John 20, "My Lord and my God." And quickly the word begins to spread that He's alive. And this became the watchword for the early church. And all the disciples were profoundly convinced that Jesus, who died, who had come back from the dead, He was now there. And all but one went to a violent death for that belief. Like, how do you account for that? And so the greatest question in life that you and I walk out with this morning is, who's Jesus? And what's my relationship to Him? And I have to be honest with you today, there's only two possible answers. Because either you believe for who He is, or you reject Him and His claims. Yes or no? Life or death? And a person, depending on their answer, is either wise or a fool, in my opinion. After 2,000 years, we can safely say that when the evidence is fairly examined with an unprejudiced mind, The only logical conclusion is that Jesus died on a Friday afternoon, that he was literally, physically, and bodily rose from the dead on a Sunday morning. And that brings me back to the basic questions once again. Is it incredible to believe that God is raised from the dead? C.S. Lewis, in his book, Mere Christianity, talks about what it means to believe in Jesus Christ, and particularly what it means to believe that Jesus Christ is really is God in human flesh, who lived, who died, and who rose again, and has ascended to heaven where he sits at the right hand of God the Father. And so what does it mean to believe in Jesus? This is what Lewis wrote. I am trying here to prevent anyone saying the real foolish thing that people often say about him. Oh, I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claims to be God. That's the one thing we must not say. A man who was merely a great moral teacher and said the sort of things Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on the level with the man who says he's a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. But you must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up as a fool, you can spit at him, you can kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that option open to us. He did not intend to. So when it comes to Easter, there are two things the people of the world can't understand. They can't understand the resurrection. It's a miracle. It's a miracle which baffles the mind. Secular man cannot deal with it. Second, because they can't deal with the resurrection, they can't figure out anybody else who can. You Christians are nuts. They all think we've gone nuts. But in the words of Paul, when he replied to Festus, we're not mad. What we believe is both true and reasonable. And this thing was not done in the shadows, this resurrection. The evidence is there for all to see. The tomb is still empty. Nobody has ever found the bones of Jesus. Nobody ever will. So far as it being a myth or a legend, the resurrection of Jesus Christ stands as the best attested fact in human history. And we invite everyone, we invite skeptics and scholars alike to examine the evidence and come to their own conclusions. So what should we do with all of this? And maybe you're here on somebody's invitation, and or you just got up this morning and thought, I should go to church, it's Easter. Well, if you've never made the choice, it's time to come to grips with it. Where do you stand on the question of Jesus? Do you stand with Festus or do you stand with Paul? Because to be honest, no question is more important, more crucial, and more vital in our world today. I think it's the greatest question of life. The question of Jesus and your relationship to him. Because there's really only two possible answers. Either you believe him for who he is, or you reject him and his claims. Yes or no. Life or death. You believe or you don't. There's no middle ground. Now I'm going to end where I began. That's pretty good, huh? I'm pretty quick today. Because honestly, for me, this is the focus of Easter. Why should any of you consider it incredible that God raises the dead? If God is God, then he can raise the dead. He did it for Jesus, he could do it for you. Some people still try to keep Jesus in the tomb, right? They try to roll a stone back over the empty tomb. Maybe that's you. Maybe what stone have you rolled in front of the tomb to keep Jesus at arm's length from invading your space? Maybe it's a stone of despair, or maybe it's a stone of doubt, or maybe it's a stone of bitterness, or maybe it's a stone of skepticism. I got news, man. Jesus came out 2,000 years ago. It's empty. And he's never going back in. I'm reminded of a little limerick of when I was a kid at Living Word Temple, my dad's church. 10-9-8, the earth begins to shake. 7-6-5, a bright light shines inside. 4-3-2-1, the stone rolls away, and Christ the Lord is risen today. The grave cannot hold him, death cannot keep him, he is alive forevermore. And there is good news from the graveyard this morning. Good news that the tomb is empty, that Jesus rose from the dead. Good news that the devil could not hold him. Good news that death has lost its sting. Good news that the grave has lost its victory. And I thank God. And let the people of God rejoice that Christ the Lord is risen today. The most important day on the calendar. Stand with us as we sing today. Parents, this is your cue to go get your kids at Soul Kids and Soul Kids Junior. Come back in, please, and we can all witness these baptisms that are about to take place this morning. But let's sing with the worship team, shall we? And let's put our hands together and make this happen and celebrate, shall we?
Into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul, this broken heart. I try with all my might, I just can't win the fight, and slowly drifting a vagabond. Just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know. He told me that I was not alone.
Pick me up, you turn me around, you place my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you heal my heart.
No choice but to believe that I was a burden, like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friends, burden and bitterness. You can just keep moving. You're welcome here. From now till I walk streets of gold, I sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found his way back home. Picks me up, you turn me around, place my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart and he changed my Savior, I thank God. Hey. Master. I thank you, Savior, because you heal my heart and you change my name. Forever free, I'm not the same. I thank the Master. I thank the Savior. I thank God. Hey!
Amen. You may be seated. Today you're going to meet people's lives, people whose lives have been changed by Jesus Christ. And maybe you need to hear what God does in the life of people so that you can embrace His love as well. You're going to witness six people being baptized. And the act of water baptism is a very important step in the Christian life. We know in Matthew, we see the Jesus himself coming to his cousin John to be baptized in order to be a fulfillment of all righteousness. And then he went on to establish baptism as an ordinance for his church, calling every believer to follow in his footsteps after the resurrection. And just as a wedding ring is an outward sign that a person is married, similarly, water baptism is a symbol designed by God to identify a person as a disciple of Jesus Christ. And so baptism in water is an outward representation of these inward realities. In the Bible, water represents cleansing in Ephesians and in Hebrews, spiritual rebirth in John chapter 3, both of which are central themes of baptism. Now, water baptism is an act of faith in which we testify both to God and to the world that the person that we were before is dead and buried, and we are raised up in a new creation in Christ. Just as resurrection demonstrates that Jesus is eternally victorious over the death and the grave, water baptism is a symbol of that as well. It's a beautiful picture. It is a witness. It's powerful. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should also walk in newness of life. So water baptism is telling everyone what is inwardly happening or has happened to me, and that I'm now clear in my commitment to turn my life and to follow Christ, that my old life is left behind. And so baptism helps us grasp the spiritual truth that the old has died. It's a public commitment. It doesn't wash away our sins. It's a picture of the resurrection. So we don't do it to impress God. We don't do it to impress other people. It's for our benefit. So you're invited today to celebrate, to make noise, to clap when people are being baptized. We have Micah Schrader, Meredith Bueller, Sam Bueller, Kayla Marie Fair, Pam Gruette, and Jenna Ha are all going to be baptized. And I want to start off by inviting Micah Schrader to stand here at the tank. And friends and family, you can come and stand around and witness, and as they are making their way, just take your time and watch the screens and pay some attention here.
My name is Micah Schrader. I'm a student at Red River College. I'm taking auto mechanics. I love sports, music, runners, shrimp and steak, and anything cars related as well. And I've been coming to Seoul for over 5 years now. I'm thankful to have grown up in a Christian home. When I was 4 or 5, my great-grandma died. We went to her funeral. And I started having questions about what happened to people when they die. So I talked to my mom about it. She explained Jesus dying on the cross for our sins and how my great-grandma was a Christian and she was going to go to heaven. She then asked if I wanted to ask Jesus into my own heart, and I said yes. And I've always been surrounded by Christians, and I went to LCS for kindergarten to grade 12. And I built up my knowledge of the Bible, but I didn't fully live it out at that point. However, I went into the leadership program at Red Rock, or called CIT, and God really showed himself to me, and I started to live for him more and more, growing in my faith. I went through a rough mental health period during the end of high school, and it affected my relationship with God as well. I pulled my shoulder and was awaiting surgery, so I couldn't play sports either, and COVID had just hit at that point as well, so I was doing school online. Isolated from others, and everything in my grade 12 year was canceled. I was in a dark place and was really struggling, dealing with these struggles in ways that weren't always healthy. After graduation, I felt lost and without purpose. I'm thankful that God saw me, knew me, and did not leave me. It was around that time where I started playing on the worship team at youth and then at Seoul, and the leaders at Seoul saw my gifts and love of music and invested time and energy in me. They helped me find community again, which was really nice. I tried to make growing my faith a priority in my life at that point. I started to create a firm foundation for my faith, and I know when hard times come, I have God to rely on and help me through everything. One of my favorite Bible verses is Psalm 107, verse 28 to 32, which says, "Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm to a whisper, and the waves of the sea were hushed. They rejoiced when his waves grew quiet. Then he guided them to the harbor they longed for. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his faithful love and his wondrous work for all of humanity. Let them exalt him in the assembly of all the people and praise him in the council of the elders." So people that have been instrumental in my faith walk are my parents, my grandparents, and my family members. They've all demonstrated how to live a life for God and the people that I can turn to and trust. And then Steph, my past youth leaders, and the worship team have also played a significant part in my faith walk, as well as so many others in my life as well. Being a Christian is loving God with all my heart and showing his love to others. It means living my life to worship him, striving to strengthen my faith every day. Loving Jesus means trusting his plan, living in obedience, and serving him for the rest of my life. I know I'm far from perfect, but I can try to live a life that is pleasing to God, glorifying him in everything I do.
Micah, can you please test the water? Surrounded by friends and family, the Mennonite clan is strong. Prayer before he goes in? First? I wanted him to freeze a little bit. Okay, Grandpa's going to pray over Micah first.
Father God, we thank you for this beautiful morning. We thank you for the blessings we've already received. And so as Micah will be baptized, we commit him to you. May his commitment to show publicly to those around him his love and desire to follow you. May he never regret this step. Bless him and keep him. May your face shine on him. We pray that in Jesus Christ's risen name. Amen.
Amen. Now you can get in, my friend. I know you're not looking at me, buddy, but that's okay. Micah, is it your desire to follow God with all your heart for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Upon confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your desire to fall in his commandment and baptism, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Our next baptismal candidate is Meredith Bueller. If you want, please watch the screen and your friends and family can come up and exchange places as the Bergman clan exits here.
Hi, I'm Meredith and I'm the youngest sibling of four kids. I love spending time with my family, dancing, playing sports, music, and singing. Knowing Jesus has always been a big part of my life because of the deep-rooted legacy in my family. I asked Jesus into my heart when I was 4 years old. When I was young, I remember loving Sunday school, singing in kids' choir, and growing up with a very strong church community, as well with a family rooted in Christ. My faith has matured over the years because of a deep desire the Holy Spirit has put on my heart to know God more. God has placed me in certain situations in my life where I've really got to know him deeper through community. I go to Linden Christian School, and I'm so blessed by the community God has given me there. Camp has also been such an incredible place for me to experience what God's presence is like, and where I've really seen him through his beautiful creation. My faith has really been tested and matured when my family went through some very challenging life-changing events that really felt like they couldn't possibly be part of God's plan. When I was 11, my family changed to just be my mom and siblings at home. This was a very difficult time and continues to impact my life and the life of my family. However, this only drew me closer to God and closer to my family, as together we learned how to fully depend on God. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. James 1 verse 2. Through this whole situation, God has revealed so much of his character and love to me, along with his faithfulness, comfort, and wisdom. I never thought that something like this could happen to me or how it could possibly be something God allowed. I really struggled not being able to control everything and was frustrated that it just happened to me with no choice in it. One of my favorite verses that really stood out to me was John 16, verse 33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. And Deuteronomy 3, verse 18. The Lord himself goes before you and he will be with you. He will never leave you or forsake you. Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. I love to spend time with God and his word. I really enjoy having Bible studies, discussing his word, reading it, journaling it, singing it in worship, and praying on it. It is a way I've really drawn near to him. I find so much joy in it, and it's not a joy, but rather it is a desire to read more. When thinking, reading, and praying about baptism, Psalm 63 has really spoke to me. You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you, my whole being longs for you, in a dry and parched land where there is no water. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I'll praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wing. Jesus did an unimaginable thing on the cross for us. A perfect God bore our sins so that we may have a relationship with him because of his unwavering, never-ending love. This isn't something I can earn or even deserve, but he still gives himself away. Why would I not want to share this incredible love of Jesus with my whole heart? Getting baptized is declaring that I belong to Jesus. I dedicate my life to him, to serve and love him, and also to serve and love others to glorify him. May the goodness that comes from God be revealed and lived from our hearts because he has redeemed our souls. Getting baptized does not mean that I know everything or that I am perfect. I am a sinner hungry for God who wants to know, love, and serve God more and more. Some people that have really drawn me close to God are my camp counselors at Red Rock, my teachers at school, and my youth leaders here at Seoul. My mom has always been such an example of me, of what it looks like to love God. I see her spending time with God, and she has such a willing heart to help others and serve God. My Om and Opa have also had a huge impact on my life and on my faith. My Om and Opa display humility and servant hearts. They are a true inspiration to me on how to live a life for Jesus. Being a follower of Christ means that I believe he died and rose again. Being a follower of Christ means that I want to grow in my faith and share it with others. It means I wake up every morning and decide to live a life dedicated to Jesus, striving to be more like him. Being a follower of Jesus means that I'm filled with this joy and light, and that light is Jesus. It means I clothe myself with the fruit of the Spirit and arm myself with the armor of God. Being a follower of Jesus means I actively participate in being an ambassador of Christ, which can look like praying, reading my Bible more, and sharing about him and worshiping him, giving him all the glory and praise.
Meredith, you've asked Sydney and Julia to pray over you, so why don't you stand between them?
Okay, let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so, so much for Meredith and for this next step that she's choosing to take. We are so, so overjoyed that she's wanting to make this public declaration of her faith and commit her life to you. We thank you for the way that your Holy Spirit has been so evidently moving in her life, and we ask that you would continue to work through her. We'd like to pray over Mare this blessing from Numbers. Lord Jesus, we pray that you would bless Mare and keep her. May your face shine upon her and be gracious to her. May you turn your face toward her and give her peace.
Lord, we pray that you would continue to strengthen her faith and guide her in your ways. Would she always know how wide, how long, how high, and how deep your love is for her. Fill her with the peace and joy that comes from only you, and help her to be a light for you no matter where she goes. We thank you again for Meredith and the amazing young woman you've created her to be. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Sounds like somebody's jealous. Meredith, is it your desire to follow God with all your heart for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Upon confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your desire to follow his command in baptism, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And now we have part two from the Bueller clan. Sam, where is he? There we are. Awesome. And there's a video for you to watch right away.
My name is Sam. I'm the only boy in my family. I'm in grade 12 at Linden Christian School, and I've been going to Seoul since grade 6. I really enjoy playing the guitar and spending time with my family and friends. Jesus has been in my story since before I was born. I was brought into a family where many of them know Jesus and live for Jesus and have shown me what that means over the years. My first memory of making my faith with my own was when I asked Jesus into my heart when I was 4 years old. I remember standing in my room and saying a prayer with my mom, and then later that day telling my friend Matthew. It was such a great day. Making my faith my own is a journey I have been on and will continue to be on as I grow closer to Him and mature in my faith. God has shown Himself to me in so many ways over my life, in both the good things and the storms that have come my way. He has revealed Himself through people who have impacted me on my faith journey through so many different experiences and through His Word, and I'm so thankful to Him for that. I have been blessed by my community at Linden Christian School, my community here at Seoul, and my many youth leaders, friends, and family that have poured into my life over these years. I'm amazed how God put people in my life to help work out His plan for me. Many years ago, my family went through a very difficult situation that forever changed my life. Through this storm, I had to learn firsthand how to lean onto God's promises to sustain me. One of these promises is found in Psalm 34, where it says, "The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. The righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes to rescue each time." My mom showed me and my sisters what it looks like to cling to Jesus, and we all grew very close to each other and to God as we spent time in His Word together every day. I learned a lot about surrendering to God in that time and continued working on surrendering to Him in all areas of my life. When I was younger, my mom gave me a framed picture of this verse, Joshua 1 verse 9, that says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." I am amazed at how much I have already needed that verse and His Word to bring me through the storms that I have already faced. As much as I can't cling to Him, I cling to His Word and His promises to guide me and not depend on myself or what I would expect life to look like, but rather trust Him to guide me, knowing that His path for me will be the best path. Recently, I went on a missions trip to Guatemala, and it was a very impactful experience. So many of the people there live in such great poverty. Seeing how much they rely on God and how thankful they are for everything was so eye-opening. That taught me that even though I have been blessed with so much earthly comfort, I absolutely need to put my trust in God and not the comforts of this world. Seeing all of the kids worshiping with 110% of themselves inspired me and moved me to surrender to God in all areas of my life. Jesus has done the most incredible thing for me on the cross, and I want to share this with the world publicly and publicly declare that He is my Savior. Some key people in my life that have drawn me to God is for sure my Oma and Opa, and seeing how faithful they are to Him every day is such an inspiration. Some more people that have brought me closer to Him are my teachers at Linden and my youth leaders here at Seoul and all of my friends that just inspire me to pursue Him every day. For me to live as a follower of Jesus, that means choosing to follow Him daily and pursuing my faith as best as I can. I want to follow Him and serve Him to the best of my ability.
Dear God, today I want to lift up Sam as he gets baptized in front of his friends and family. I thank you for his desire to take this step and get baptized today. And I pray that this moment would be a stepping stone forward in continuing to grow closer to you, that he would never settle and grow complacent, but always strive to put you first in every aspect of his life. Thank you for the amazing man that he is, and ask that you would help him to continue to be a light and example to his friends and peers and everyone around him. I ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
So Sam, is it your desire to follow God with all your heart for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Upon confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your desire to follow him in the commandments of baptism, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We would now like to invite Kayla Marie Fair and her family and friends to the platform. And in doing so, just please watch the screens.
My name is Kayla. I am 14 years old and I go to Springs Christian Academy and I love sports. What led me to believe in Jesus and how I really started to believe in him, I grew up in a Christian home and I've always believed in God and I knew there was a God, but I never really made faith my own, I guess, until this past summer at camp where I got called out by Mark from Rose Church and he talked over my life. So that's when I really started to make my faith my own and that's when I started taking it more seriously. The decision for me to get baptized was a big roller coaster. At first, that's when I was like, wow, I really want to start making this my own. And so I started off with just seeing like changes in my life. After a bit, I guess I kind of just stopped hearing from him and I was like, what's happening? Like, I don't know what to do. And I remember one day sitting in my room and I found the book that I would write in at camp. And I was reading through it and then I wrote down what Mark said about me, but I kept on reading and then it was saying all this stuff of how like I would have to lose my popularity, my friends, I'd have to lose so much in my life to be able for him to use me. With that, I started to realize that this was exactly what was happening. And yes, in this moment, it felt like it sucked, but then I really realized that this is how he's using me. And he was always working in the background of my life, even when I didn't see it. After a bit, I started to get like close with him again. And then I was like, okay, God, I think I want to actually give this all to you now. The next day at school, funny enough, out of the blue, all of a sudden we started talking about baptism and how it was like, you don't need to be perfect and your life doesn't need to be perfect for you to actually get baptized. And instantly in that moment, I was like, okay, this is what I want to do. Some key people in my life that have really drew me closer to God was definitely my parents. They're always so encouraging in my walk with God. Also my grandparents, they're also very encouraging with that. And they always tell me stories from the Bible and always just apply it to their life and my life. And also definitely my youth leaders. My youth leaders have been a big part of my journey and my walk. They're always just so encouraging and always just there for me. And they've definitely always just encouraged me even in those dark times that they're there and God's there. What it looks like to be a follower of Jesus moving forward, I think would just be to just be a servant for him and show people the love of God. I feel like so many people just don't feel like loved and appreciated and accepted. And I want to be able to show people that God does love them. And us as followers, we do love people just as he would love them, just serving him in any way I can.
And Kayla's mom will pray over.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day where we gather together to celebrate your resurrection and to celebrate the new life that you offer us. We thank you for Kayla. We thank you for the blessing she has been in the lives of so many. We thank you for allowing us as her parents, family, and friends the opportunity to be a part of her life thus far. And we thank you for the privilege of celebrating this next step she is taking in her faith journey. As she stands here today publicly declaring that she is dedicating her life to you and choosing to follow you, we ask that you guide her and give her the courage and strength to walk the path you will set before her. As she faces difficult times, trials, and tribulations, may she always seek your face and look to the only one who can help her through difficult times. We pray that she is able to discern your voice from all the others that will be trying to get her attention. And we ask that she will be a light to those around her and a reflection of your love so that others may come to know you. And we pray that you continue to give us as family and friends wisdom to speak your words of truth into her life. We thank you for her, in Jesus' name. Amen.
into the tank. I've been waiting 14 years for this. Dwayne, we don't play here now.
Kayla has asked her dad and Pastor Jerry to baptize her. Kayla, is it your desire to follow God with your whole heart for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Upon the confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your desire to follow his command in baptism, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Pam Gruet is our next baptismal candidate. Please watch the screens.
My name is Pam. I'm 65 years old. I have three children, grown children, and I have five grandchildren. I have a wonderful family. The Lord has blessed me with a very loving family, nice long life and health. When my family was young, we went to a Christian Life Assembly. My husband prayed for a church, and we got a flyer in the mail that invited us to Christian Life Assembly. We went there, and during, I believe it was a Easter service, I accepted Christ as my Savior. Well, I chose to be baptized today to show obedience to Christ and also to strengthen my relationship with Jesus. I know that I'm a new person in Jesus. I know that I'm loved, that I'm forgiven, and I trust in Jesus. He'll give me strength and courage to look for and find the joy that is in life. My mom and my husband, I would say, were key people that influenced my belief in the Lord. My mom, because I was baptized as a child. She made sure I went to church all the time. I went to a youth group. I went to Christian camp. I was confirmed as a young adult. My husband was a big influence because he showed me, he was an example, excuse me, he was an example of a Christian man who applied the word as he saw it in his life. He prayed, read the Bible, he prayed with me, he talked with me, and he applied the word in his life. To live as a follower of Jesus, I strive to seek him first, to pray continually through the day, small things, big things, but just to have that relationship and to talk to the Lord, to be an example, to show love to people, to kindness, generosity, and to be joyful.
Pamela has asked Pastor Jerry to pray a prayer of blessing over her.
And before I do, I got to tell people how we met. So one day I'm walking down the aisle here, and Pam walks right up to me and goes, "Hi." I go, "Hi, my name's Jerry." She goes, "My name's Pamela." You don't know me. I go, "Okay, all right, we just got your name. I've been watching for years." So it was almost like you've barely been here in person. And finally, you just said, "You know, the Lord's been speaking to me, and I just feel the need to get baptized." So you've came, and you're here. And it's just great that you're part of the family. Good to have you. Let me pray for you. Father, thank you for the precious gift of baptism, and that we can publicly declare our love and passion for you. And Lord, we ask for your goodness and blessing to be poured out on Pamela to this day. We pray that you would work deeply within her heart and soul to renew and refresh her each day. Come guide her footsteps, give her a hope and a vision for the future. Today, the past is gone, and she stands free and whole, loved and forgiven within the kingdom of God. Father, just cover and protect her now. Encircle her with your promises and fill her heart with joy. And may this day be one she cherishes and remembers forever. Amen. follow you.
All right. Pam, is it your desire to follow God with all your heart for the rest of your life?
Yes, it is.
Upon the confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your desire to follow his command in baptism, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Congratulations. Blessings. Our final one is our candidate is Jenna Ha. So if Jenna and her family and friends can come up, that would be awesome. Please watch the screen.
My name is Jenna. I'm 18 years old, and I recently graduated high school. I love gardening and creating art. I'm very excited to get baptized today. I was born in a Christian home, so I accepted Christ at a very young age. I sort of grew up knowing Jesus rather than building a relationship with him. After a while, I kind of became spiritually numb. High school was a low point in my faith, and not just because of work. There were tons of distractions. YouTube, TikTok, Instagram. I began to have certain fixations that I was really attached to. I began to get very anxious about people and what they thought, and I was afraid of saying or doing the wrong thing. I would overthink everything and began to doubt my faith. I was tired of being afraid. So one night I just sat down and prayed to God. I talked to him about all the things that were weighing on me, and I asked him for forgiveness. Ever since then, my spiritual life has picked up, and now I want to take things more seriously with Jesus. I had some fantastic people in my life that inspired me to be a better Christian, such as my friends, school teachers, and my family. Me and my mom would sit down and have deep talks. She was a big influence on my faith journey. I want to live my life being more compassionate, understanding, and patient, showing God's love to all people. I want to work hard for God with the tasks that I have. I want to live my life for Him and follow Him in all that I do.
I'm going to pray.
Yeah. Sorry, my mic wasn't on. Mom's praying.
Okay. Thank you, Lord, for drawing Jenna to this point to declare faith in you publicly. I pray for continued growth in her spiritual life to desire you on an even deeper level. As Psalm 91 says, Lord, I pray that you protect her in all of her ways and that you cover her. Teach her, O Holy Spirit, to dwell under your shelter all the days of her life and cause her to be sensitive to your leading and stay close to you. I also pray that you would bless her with a boldness that she has never known before and a confidence that comes from knowing that you are empowering her. I'm so grateful that we are here today, Lord, and it is because of you. I give you thanks and praise, and once again, Lord, we give her to you. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Face this way here. Get the camera. Because we have to have proof to God afterwards that you actually went under the water. It's cold. Eh?
Jenna's asked her mom and Pastor Jerry to baptize her. Jenna, is it your desire to follow God with all your heart for the rest of your life?
Yes, it is.
Upon the confession of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your desire to follow his command in baptism, we now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So, why don't you stand with me? It's been a great morning so far. If you choose to give towards our Easter offering, they'll put the ways back up on the screen if you wish to do it electronically, or you could do it on the joy basket on your way out. And we have an Easter treat for you as you leave. God, just give me a woo-hoo. All right.
All right. In ancient times, the one who blessed extended his hands for the blessing. Those receiving the blessing, this likewise. If you want a blessing before you go, just put your hands in the air, and here it is. As Christ burst forth from the tomb, may new life burst forth from us and show itself in acts of love to a hurting world. May the loving power of God, which raised Jesus to new life, strengthen you in hope, enrich you with his love, and fill you with his joy. And may the same Jesus who lives forever and is the source of new life keep your hearts rejoicing and grant you peace. Now, go and live the church. He is risen! Be blessed.
Because you heal my heart.